Jerry, would it be fair to say that these days you're more cheerful than driven?
A mixture of both. Obviously, you know, I always believe that there's always an element of pain and also an element of insecurity. And that's something that really, I think, so that lethal cocktail will always, is always embedded in you almost. Yeah. And it doesn't matter, you know, what happens to you really. I don't think that leaves you until you're 70.
Sure. But would one of the Jerry rules these days now be like, show your imperfections, I am who I am?
You know, no one buys into that kind of facade of, you know, perfect people. It just doesn't wash with anybody anymore.
So did you have to kind of feel that you had to learn to like yourself before getting the approval of other people? That you and you was first, and then let's see what other people think?
I think, you know, that just comes with age anyway. You know, no one is ever completely satisfied with themselves because you're ever changing. So you have to keep on learning who you are.
Yeah.
You're kind of playing catch-up with yourself almost. But it is a case, I think, that comes with maturity. You say, well, actually, you know, this is who I am. Maybe you know, not everybody's going to like you, but you can't please everybody, but you can just be yourself.
Yeah.
But obviously everyone wants to be liked, don't they?
Sure, absolutely.
You know, you care what your neighbours think.
Everyone wants approval, yeah.
Yeah, they do. It doesn't matter what you... It's that I always have this mentality that, you know, if you live in a little road, OK, and number seven, his husband, he won the fishing competition and he got a, you know, full-size trout. He and his picture was in the newspaper. He'd be so proud and want to, you know, show everybody and, you know...
Down the pub that night.
Yeah, go, look at this, you know, I did well.
Yeah.
You know, so it doesn't matter what scale it is.
Yeah.
That's what I think.
OK, but, like, you used to do it differently, I think, in terms of, like, if the first solo single will show that this is the new Jerry in some ways, the way you used to do it, you called yourself Miss Soundbite, you were the biggest mouth, the biggest boobs, the biggest everything, the biggest ever, like, you know, tabloid this and headline that. Is that the past completely?
I don't know, it's quite the past. At the end of the day, you know, I've always just, you know, whatever I looked like before, the way that, whatever I behaved as me, there was nothing contrived about it. But I think that, you know, when you're a teenager, you're full of bravado and cockiness. And I think as you just get older, you learn to relax and actually say, and you just change. That's all. And you realise sometimes that, you know, less is more. When you're, you know, younger, you know, I developed very late in life. So I was like, oh, my God, wow, I've got a chest. Look at this.
Yeah.
And let's pile on as much makeup as, you know, I possibly can because I want to look older. But I think, you know, everyone goes through that. Everyone looks back at scrapbooks themselves and goes, oh, my God. Mm. And what was I behaving like at that party or whatever?
Yeah.
I'll wrap myself from around my finger. Hold me too tight.
You were in the middle of one of the greatest things ever, supposedly. You took the bull by the horns and said, right, I've had enough, I'm going to do something else. The something else has worked out brilliantly so far. Now, I presume it's going to continue to work out brilliantly, but so far it has worked out absolutely brilliantly. Now, the point is
that
when you left, I mean, like, you were very much a solo person. There wasn't somebody to look after your bags there. There wasn't a car to take you here.
No.
It was all kind of different. You had to do some things on your own as opposed to the previous 4 or 5 years. So the first question there would be, had you, even though it was you, as you say, did you hide behind Ginger in some ways, and now you are Jerry Halliwell?
I think everybody hides behind something, you know, whether you're a bank manager and you put your suit on for the day, you know,
point.
If you're a teacher, that gives you identity. Everybody hides behind being a father or a mother or different things, different roles within life.
Yeah.
None of them are fake. But, and of course, absolutely, you know, I didn't have to go give off anything else, didn't have to work any, you know, work, give anything. So, you know, I was hiding behind that to point, yeah. And the point that I was relying on, you know, the whole unit around me, because when, particularly when you're on tour, it's a massive, you know, community machine. Mm. You know, you've got the trucks, the people, the da-da-da. It's like a travelling circus, you know. And in a way, you know, you could become dependent on that in so many ways. I think it was very strange for me because, you know, since I was 16, I've been very, very resourceful and looked after myself. And then suddenly, you know, you become dependent. You do. You're almost disabled, you know, and emotionally, in so many levels. And so then when I, you know, left, it was like, oh, it's just me.
But when you say there was loads of people around, which there were, was it the five of you, though, really against the world, and now is it just you? I mean, like you know, the five...
I think, 50,
but the other 45, let's leave
them out. Yeah, I think at the end of the day, you know, we were at probably the strongest when, you know, it's like a football team or sailors sailing a ship on very stormy seas. When the weather is really tough, you're gonna have to be like that to get through it. Yeah. That's when we were our strongest, and it was. You know, I'm really proud of where I come from. Had a great time, wouldn't be here now. And you know, now, you know, I'm just trying to establish myself and you know, have a career. Do you know what I mean? Career, longevity. I love making music. I so do. That's one thing that I feel confident is writing pop tunes. I can come up with, you know, poptastic melodies, and I love lyrics. And I like writing for people to sing along to. You know, because music has given me so much. It's kept me company, you know, in times of pain or just loneliness. You put on music and it can lift you up. It can speak to you. It can just, it's so powerful, music. And I love doing that, and I love performing those two parts. And so I'm just trying to earn the privilege to do that, to continue to do that. And it's not guaranteed, I know that. You know, like you said, it's going up to now, today, it's great.
Yeah.
You know, but I know that you have to keep on working at it. But it's like anything, in a relationship, you have to keep on working. You're going to have tough times and good times, and you have to get through them.
But like when you say the poptastic tunes that you write, I mean, like on the album Schizophrenic, you wrote all 10 tracks in terms of co-writing right now. Were you doing that after Spice Girls, or were you doing
during? You know what? During the Spice Girls, I was very instrumental in the writing, and I'm very proud of it.
For the solo album, I mean, even when you were really, as you said, lonely after Spice Girls, how did you get up the gumption to get a pen out?
Do you know what? I probably write better when I'm, as soon as I have emotion.
Pressure,
The minute I left the band, I was writing. You know, I find it very therapeutic.
Yeah.
You know, something happens to me, I'll put it down on paper and write it in an expression of poem.
Yeah.
And then sometimes I just put melodies down or they stick in my mind. You know, and I've got some in my head now and I think I'm using them. They've stayed with me. I'm going to use them for my second album.
OK, but staying with then, the writing at that time, when you're there by yourself, solo in other words, trying to get a successful solo career going, and it worked when it came about. When you talk back about a few of the things that had happened to you, would one of them go right back to the very beginning? Just say, for instance, the idea of having to go up the M1 or all the way up to Scotland to do some silly radio promo, as opposed to flying to Cannes or flying to New York.
No, the kind of writer that I am, I would say, is if I write for people, no one's going to identify with room service and driving up in a coach on the M1.
Right.
Not many people.
Okay.
You know, flying to so-and-so, and I find that pretty dull, actually. I think the most exciting thing is, you know, I connect with women, okay, and I like writing about life and what is life, and that's feeling, love, emotion, sex, ambition, work, just all those general things that women really, really feel. And that's how I, you know, want to connect with them. And I'll pull my own experience into it, but then make it broad enough so everybody can identify with it. You know, so it's not completely self-indulgent. It's
okay,
for everyone.
But you have just encapsulated there something that you really did invent, as far as I'm concerned, which is this girl power thing, which you believed was a good thing, which the rest of them probably thought was a good thing to get going. Then they dropped it a bit, and you believed it totally. Did you feel if that was in any way at all a revolution from your point of view, that the revolution had been betrayed by the other four?
No.
You're still out of there now, which is like, you know.
Do you know what I believe? That, you know, I didn't invent girl power. Girl power was synchronicity. The world, you know, you know, in a way it got sloganized a little bit, but I actually believe, you know, I wear my heart on my sleeve, I really do, and I've always been a very passionate person, and I believed in it then and I believe in it now, but it's just developed, you know, and you've got to understand everyone's interpretation of a word or a song or anything, you know, just an adjective. is different. Everyone identifies it in their own way, which is fine, which is great, which makes this world a very colourful place. And I don't think any of us have the right to judge anybody else on, you know, on anyone else's behaviour, you know, or how they respond to something, you know. And I'm just very... I like to connect with people, so if people find it inspiring from the word girl power, then that's great. I mean, for me now, it feels like it's woman power, it's willpower. You know, that kind of sense of, you know, it's just a very basic empowerment. You get empowered, but you can feel empowered by anything, you know, from the sunshine to music to an A-level result. You know, something that gives you the will to go, you know what, I can do this. And for me, because I know that I've come from a really, you know, not the most privileged background. I had a plastic spoon in my mouth. You know, I was a jumble sale kid. I didn't go to stage school. I didn't have all those opportunities. But with, you know, what other, I just grasped onto, you know, other people's, what they had done, and thought, God, that's fantastic. You know, maybe I could do that too. If you the two and two
Our program will return in a moment. An Ovation. The program now returns. An Ovation. The Arts Network.
When you're a teenager, you stomp through everything, out of my way, I'm coming through. But actually, you know, we should just need a little bit more consciousness about, you know what, everything I do affects you and everything you do affects me. You know, you should have aware of your consequences.
Right. Yeah.
So I think, you know, and that's just about age.
Speaking of age, your dad was extremely, like, a hell of a lot old. Like, he was very old.
He was 50 when I was born.
When you were born, so when you were a teenager, he was very old. But at the same time, he did introduce you to a lot of things, didn't he? Literature, etc.
Yeah, totally. I mean, he loved politics for a start, and he was very into old movies and kind of jazz music, and you know the kind of music from the 40s and the 50s.
Sure, yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Like Monroe and Frank Sinatra and that kind of thing. So, you know, that's he didn't show me the Beatles. He showed me that kind of thing. And, you know, and he was a real romantic.
So you were getting the jazz and the Wham at the same time?
Yes, I was, those two levels, yeah.
And obviously school was giving you Wham, etc.
Yeah.
And father was giving you the jazz.
It's funny, though, because you don't realise how much you are your parents' children until you go in and analyse how much an effect they have on you. They so do. They put their fears into you, their own fears, but their own, you know, you get the good bits and the bad bits from them. It so makes you who you are. It really does.
Sounds like you'd like to be a mother, Jerry.
My mother, she...
No, sounds like you'd like to be a mother.
Oh, my God.
No, plenty of time for that.
Yeah, I mean, I think motherhood is like... You've got to learn to be a good mother to yourself first.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Such responsibility, just think.
OK, but there's a huge responsibility now as Jerry Halliwell, solo person, right? So, is it... I mean, no... James Bond said, never say never again. Could it ever be possible that you could go back with the others again?
You can never say never, you just don't know what's around that corner. But at the moment, I don't know.
I'm not talking about, the moment.
I mean, I'm saying what James Bond said.
Right, okay. But in one way, you would have liked to continue with them in some ways, but you felt because of certain pressures, there's the whole story about you wanted to do a thing for ITN about breast cancer. They said no because the schedule didn't allow it. You said, listen, hold on a second, schedule, I'm me.
Yeah.
I'm out of here. Now, in one way, you didn't really want to go. It wasn't like that, really.
No, I loved being in the band.
That's what I mean.
Do you know what I mean? How could I not be?
That's misconceived by a lot of people.
No, I loved being it. I was mortified that, that I had to leave. But, you know, sometimes in life, your integrity and your, you know, your own values take over. But actually, you know, I gave everything to that band. They were my family.
Yeah.
You know, so part of me just did not want to go. You know, you want to hold on to what you know. And, you know, maybe if things had been different, I would have stayed forever.
Yeah.
But then everything changes, it really does, and everything has to go in a different direction. And, you know, maybe it worked out for the best. You know, that I'm sure that...
Over to Istanbul to start the tour, then to make an album. Did you ever have time to say, hold on a second, are we in, where are we now? It's Tuesday, it must be Istanbul.
I think, you know what, I've just suddenly come to the conclusion that, you know, I believe in fate and destiny, and I just think I'm one of these people, whatever I'm happen to be doing, you know, this year has been a emotional roller coaster.
Right.
And I think what you have to do is remind yourself, no matter what you're doing, is that you're lucky. You're so lucky to be, you know, whether you're meeting Mandela, which is fantastic, this, you know, that's phenomenal to be able to have the opportunity to meet a man like that, you know, to have, you know, fans appreciating what you're doing, it's brilliant. And I think I've got the best fans in the world, if you're watching, I think you're great. But I think some of the most important thing is your health, to have that. Without that, you have nothing, you know, and every day is a gift, it so is, because, you know, time is going to go so fast.
Sure.
And one day you're here and the next minute you're not. And so...
You've often mentioned in the past that meeting Nelson Mandela was one of the most important things that's ever happened to you in your whole life.
Yeah.
Certainly as a Spice Girl and or solo now, whatever. But the thing about it is that when I saw the interview, were you prompting the questions to him because he's a bit deaf, because he couldn't hear the questions?
Yes,
is that it?
That's right.
Okay, and the second thing about that is this. Did you notice anything about millions of photographers there that was different than the way you might see millions of photographers in the Spice Girls or as Jerry Halliwell? In other words, were they a lot more... sedate and like...
Yes, it was
a
much...
You can actually have a nice paparazzi.
That actually was a very serene affair, which was very nice. I mean, normally, Jerry.
Yeah.
But, I mean, everyone was a lot more respectful, which is nice.
Right. With the UN thing that you're, what, still doing?
Yeah, absolutely.
And
yeah.
What does that mean you have to do? How many days of the year does it take up?
It's not, you know, I would say a clock-in, clock-out situation.
Yeah.
You know, what I can give to the UN, first and foremost, is my fame. Because I'm famous, that's why they picked me for a start, one of the criteria of what I do. But, you know, but then my audience is younger people. And the sad thing is, you know, there's some fantastic people at the United Nations, but, you know, no one's going to listen to, you know, when they want to talk about an issue.
Yeah.
So I bring, say, everybody, look at this. I don't claim to be a wisdom of knowledge, you know, pool of knowledge, but I'm learning with it. And, you know, and it's kind of very it's a lifelong project. You know, I did a mission this year, which was fantastic. You know, I went to the Philippines and they wanted me to highlight the fact that there's lots of clinics out there that need government funding.
Yeah.
You know, there's a very high population out there. You know, and it's not about actually giving your views, you know, kind of and criticising anybody's religious, cultural ideals. It's not about
Your involvement and your fame.
No, it's giving everybody a choice.
Yeah, exactly.
You know,
saying,
do you know what? Everyone
deserves
education and everyone deserves the right to choose whether they want to go, you know, go to a clinic and have the same health education rights that we, you know, Great Britain take, you know, we take for granted sometimes.
Yeah.
And the great thing was, you know, after I left the government, you know, I was out there on behalf of the United Nations and you know, I spoke to the kids. They wanted it. They so wanted the same chances that we have. And it was them that asked me to go there. And after I left, the government gave money. And, you know, so that's mission accomplished. And so, you know, I have another mission next year. It's like a fine balance. Mothers, you know, lots of women have, lots of people have different roles in life, you know, and you have to work at them all.
As well, I mean, you've got to understand just how important it happens to be.
I think you shouldn't abuse it. You can, you know, you could jump queues in fancy restaurants, which is nice, and I appreciate that, you know, sometimes I'm going to get a table somewhere.
Yeah.
And I'm aware of that. And, but then I think you've got to use it carefully. At the end of the day, it's not real either. You know, it's so fickle. One day you're hot and the next you're not. So what I focus on is, you know, I'm proud to, as I said before, just be doing what I'm doing. I'm very expressive. You know, I've got lots of creativity and I think everybody has to a degree. And just to be able to, from the videos to the artwork to the ideas, I love doing that. You know, and I just think, God, I'm so lucky. You know, there's people in jobs that, you know, I could be working in a factory, you know, just doing that, you know, putting eggs in boxes for, you know, 7 hours a day. But I instead, I'm doing something amazing.
And what's the Jerry Halliwell live experience on stage going to be in terms of, like, you and a band, is it, or what is it?
I mean, I've already done some live dates,
you
know,
some gigs,
especially
in
America. And, you know, I wanted to give a great show, you know, give good show. That's what I want to do, and be entertaining and funny.